again, and welcome to PCP. It's PCP 600, part 2. And if you listen to the first episode of PCP 600, you know that this is a show where I'm going to sort of focus on some of the interviews I've done with various artists and people over the years. And this is the second part, starting from January 2011 all the way up to the end of 2018. And we began in January 2011 with a Skype conversation with Sam and Fred from Planet Terror Records. Let's have a listen to them. We'll see what they have to say.
Well, we got started in October 2008, which was a split release from both of us, Mantra and Jack Orion. I suppose it was a long while coming, really. We spent a few months discussing the idea of starting a label and being fairly broke and not businessmen. We decided to start a label that didn't involve money. Big fans of Net Audio and the idea of it, the idea of giving out music for free, I think is quite a pure one and quite honest. So that was the centre of it, really, and it's grown from there. We've got more and more local people. We're based in Sheffield, so we've got a lot of people from the local area, a lot of producers that we've kind of got to know over the last couple of years who are forming a kind of core of artists that we're working with now.
So what sort of music are you sort of aiming to produce on your net label?
Well, over the last couple of years, we've released a lot of different styles of music. We've had some hip-hop, some techno, some electronica, a fair amount of dubstep and dub. And I think when we started the label, we really didn't intend to have any specific style. At the time, we were both really into dubstep, which was just kind of breaking out a little bit. But since then, we've really gone with what we like musically, as opposed to trying to find some kind of style that we always want to keep to.
People need to understand the benefits of giving away some music for free. It can be a really good step up for people. I mean, our sixth release was Barbarics, who's now had shortly afterwards had a release on Hospital Records, a remix of a Mr. Bishy track, and Culprit's done quite well as well, and we're happy for them to just carry on. And obviously we don't actually sign people up, there's no contract involved, there's none of that. So yeah, really it's about giving people a leg up who we think are good.
We'll be right back.
lot of stuff. So two bits of information there. The first of which was an interview from January 2011 with Sam and Fred from Planet Terror. Planet Terror doesn't have a website anymore, but you can still find something at soundcloud.com/planet-terror-records. And then we had a track that was on one of their albums by Adam Kroll. And you can find more about Adam at beatport.com/artist/Adam-Kroll. And then there's some numbers, that's a K-R-O-L-L. Best to check out PCP 600 Part 2 on the website at peakogle.com and you'll find out more information. Right, moving on, staying in 2011, I did a few interviews in 2011 actually, but moving to February, we had Moshi Kamache from King Dub.
So all the way from Paris in France, we have Moshi Kamache. How are you doing?
Great.
Good. Well, we've been talking online for a couple of years now, haven't we?
Yeah. I met a few people via Twitter, and you're one of them that's always been supportive, you know.
Well, it's good to hear your stuff. So tell me a little bit about your net label. What's it called, and how long have you been running, etc.?
It's called Kingdub Records. It's a pretty young label. Well, actually, it's a baby. The label was born, the idea was born a long time ago, maybe 10 years ago, and took me all that time to get all the ideas together, and it's the whole story started last summer, last August.
Okay.
With the first album.
Tell us where the listeners can find you.
Well, there are a few places. Kingdub.com, which is the radio. And there are shows every day. The label, you can find it on records.kingdub.com.
Is there anything I should have asked you that I haven't done?
I would like to tell you thank you. Really, I mean it, because you're one of the first one that wrote about what I was trying to do, been, you know, promoting your own way, what we are doing. I know it's because of people like you that we can exist, you know. People that gonna say, okay, let's look on the net, maybe new tracks, new guys, and we have to say thank you to you.
Well, I would have to say thank you to you, because without your music I wouldn't be able to do it.
Thank you.
was DocumentOne, DocumentOne Dubstep, and you can find them at soundcloud.com/DocumentOne, that's DocumentOne. The track was called Find Me, and that came out on King Dub Records, and before that we heard Moshi Kamache from King Dub, which you can find at soundcloud.com/King-Dub-Records, talking about his record label, rather good it was too. Right, next one was a conversation I had with PK from Peppermill Records. That was they're based in British Columbia in Canada. And this is a very interesting one because this told me an awful lot about things I just didn't know about planting trees in British Columbia and music. And then there's a track afterwards which just sums up the whole thing. So let you have a listen to what PK had to say and then listen to a track by a band called A Hawk and a Hacksaw.
So here I am with PK from Peppermill Records over there in British Columbia in Canada. So how are you, man?
I am great. Hello, Pete.
So tell us a bit more about Peppermill Records.
It's something I started to keep busy during the winters off from tree planting in northern Canada. And it's about 5 years old. We do mostly themed collaborative projects with many different styles of music, from folk to rock, jazz, gypsy jazz, electronic. So it's any style is I don't know if anything would really tie it together that way, but we do a lot of visuals as well. I get just as much thrill discovering illustrators as I do musicians, so it's kind of a collective with me at the top.
You mentioned tree planting a couple of times there now, so tree planting is obviously a big thing for you.
Well, yeah, the thing is, it's I did it for about 10 years, and now I'm basically done. It's this job where you live out in the bush for 3 months. Sometimes in the mountains. I started off doing it more in the flatter parts of Canada, and it pays well. It's a bunch of young people, travelers, and I quite enjoyed it. But it's really hard on the body, and I'm basically retired now, which is a shame. I still go back like a little bit every year. But you meet so many, like, you meet people, all these different music tastes, artists, travelers. So I really like that kind of, those kind of personalities.
One of the things I noticed on your site, and I've never seen another net label, is your festivals. Tell me more about your festivals, because they sound really intriguing.
Well, that started as a that was supposed to be a release party for the High and Ho We Plant Trees album, because I plant trees with these people. They're very outdoorsy, and I thought, okay, if I'm gonna have a release party, we might as well put it. And I was living in northern BC, and there was this on Google Earth, I saw this lake on top of a mountain that nobody around there had even basically heard of. But it seemed accessible, so I thought, why not have a party up there? So I started planning it, but then I found out it was a very rainy area. It started raining, and it was too late in the season, so I called it off. But then over the winter, I decided, let's try and make this more of an actual festival. The original idea was to do an acoustic festival and then represent the other parts of the label and do something electronic somewhere else. But it was just so much fun the first time that we did it a couple more times.
So you basically hike up into the hills with your musical instruments and a couple of recorders.
Well, actually, I make the performers everybody hike up to some place I found on Google Earth, a different spot every year. But I do hire a chopper to fly up the food and the drinks and the instruments. So that way it's a little bit nicer hike. You don't, even though it's quite strenuous to get to the location, which makes it a lot more rewarding, because these are like alpine paradises. They're really beautiful.
Yeah.
And then but at least we're not hiking big backpacks up, just people carry some personal belongings like their tent.
You want to do the man soldier here?
Yes.
Sorry, we don't have any sing-alongs.
That's okay.
I had to leave, so.
You can
hum.
Everyone's boring right now, so awesome. We can deal with it. The sing-along.
I'm foggy. My brain is foggy right now.
In a good way.
Yeah, maybe I should stand.
Are you gonna stand?
Yeah.
You want to dance?
I might.
Yes.
Got it.
We're gonna roll down the hill.
Yeah, just probably. Watch where you step. Yeah.
Fire is so
hot. Oh, I'm getting up, man.
Ready?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Hawk and a Hacksaw, and a track called The Man Who Sold His Beard. You can find them at ahawkandahacksaw.bandcamp.com. But that particular track came out on Peppermill Records, and you can find Peppermill Records at archive.org/details/Peppermill. And I just love the fact that you can hear the fire crackling in the background there. You know exactly where they're going to be, because PK has just told you that, you know, they've hiked their way up to the top of this hill. A helicopter has brought the food and the equipment, and they're just up there and they're having a fantastic time playing music. It's just so evocative. It's just so evocative. I absolutely love that bit. Great to hear, and a great label. Moving on to another great label, we've now got PS, another artist, another impresario from Enough Records. And after that, we're going to hear a track from his label by Daizy.
So now I'm on Skype with Philip, aka PS, from Enough Records.
Hello, how are you doing?
So, Philip, tell me a bit about your net label.
Well, my net label is called Enough Records, as you was mentioning. We've been active for, I think, 10 years now. We were started in 2001. It came out from a net radio experiment that we were having, me and a couple of friends. And we ended up turning the net radio into a net label and then dropping the net radio altogether. So that's how the net label was originally formed.
So when it comes to sort of success, how would you measure success?
It's a very good question. I really don't know. Well, for me, it's to keep releasing. You know, if I keep the label afloat, keep promoting the releases, that's my measure of doing a good job at the end of the day. But I would like the artists to get more known. That's also very good. We had a few artists that ended up getting signed on labels to have like a limited edition CDRs and stuff like that. I guess that's a good measurement of success as well, or acceptance of on some levels. But I don't know. I guess the main point that I wish I would have on the label is that have more people coming in and trying to get a snowball effect on the label itself.
Was called Unexpected by Daizy. That's Daizy. You can find them at freemusicarchive.org/music/Daizy. And before that, we heard something from Enough Records, on which that the track came out. Recorded in 2011, April 2011, I had a conversation with PS from Enough Records, and you can find them still going at enoughrecords.scene.org, and PS has his own podcast which comes out on a regular basis as well, so definitely worth checking that out. Right, so for the first few years of going to the Great Escape Festival, it started in 2006, but we didn't get there until 2007. It was just me and Mr. Snelling, and then Mr. Clitheroe, being sort of, you know, doesn't like to be left out of things, decided in May 2011 to come along just for one day. And he brought a lady with him, name of Jordan Reyne.
We're joined by two other people, one of which is me, Omar, and Mr. Clitheroe. How you doing?
I'm doing terribly well, Coach.
And this is your first time down at the Great Escape?
First Great Escape. Yes.
Amazing.
I don't know how I managed to miss it so many times, but anyway, that's enough about me.
And you've got a guest with you.
I'm absolutely thrilled to introduce Jordan Reyne to you and your listeners.
Hello, Jordan.
Hello, it's nice to be here.
Jordan, and you're not from these parts.
How can you tell?
It might be the accent.
It might be the accent. This is my first Great Escape too, but I have the excuse of having been in the Southern Hemisphere. Distinct disadvantage in many ways.
Cool. And you're an artist as well?
Yes, I'm a musician doing, I guess, bloodthirsty Celtic industrial music.
Oh, I'm going to have some of that. Now that you've mentioned the genre, yeah. I mean, I just love people that can come up with their own genre. Bloodthirsty Celtic industrial. You have two new fans and we haven't even heard the music yet.
Brilliant. Good stuff. CDs with you? You can sell these guys?
I have CDs in my suitcase that weighs 50 kilos.
Oh, well, Peter can carry it for you.
Yeah, he's already offered, actually. Yeah. He said, I did used to be a roadie.
Once a roadie, always a roadie.
Yeah.
Yes.
And you also said that it's illegal to have a suitcase that's that,
I think
that's
so.
That heavy.
I think there's a regulation that says that no suitcase should weigh that much.
Well, is there a
Nobody's
reason
allowed
that?
To pick it up. You can't even buy a bag of cement that weighs that much.
No.
That's illegal now.
Yeah.
It has to come in like no bigger than a shopping bag.
But of course, you are used to illegal suitcases being a roadie, aren't you? For the whalers.
Thinking of home, I romanticize size fields and the cycles of seasons and farms. I arrived and I married and I waited for the roots to take hold. But I wake every night to the sound of the sea. So loud, 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 she says, Johnny, come home, Johnny, come home, Johnny, come home. Johnny, come home, Johnny, come home, come home. Johnny, come home, Johnny, come home, Johnny, come home. Johnny, come home, Johnny, come home, come home. You forget how to swim once your life doesn't throw you too far. Like you hope that the land can still hold you and keep you here warm. But I hear and I see and I'm sick of the earth and its gaze. So I'm walking out once, I am walking out into the waves. They say, Johnny, come home, Johnny, come home, Johnny, come home. Johnny, come home, Johnny, come home, come home. Johnny, come home, Johnny, come home, Johnny, come home. Johnny, come home, Johnny, come home, come
Jordan Reyne, and one of her early tracks called Johnny in the Sea. You can find out more about her at jordanreyne.com, that's J-O-R-D-A-N, and then Reyne is R-E-Y-N-E, from New Zealand, as you can probably tell. And then we had Peter Clitheroe and Jordan having a conversation with us a bit earlier in May 2011, when Peter joined us for the first great escape of his career, and he's been with us ever since. Oh dear, dear, dear. Now, it's not all about me interviewing somebody else or somebody else interviewing somebody else. It's about, occasionally, me being interviewed. I used to work for Nokia during 2010 and 2011. And in June 2011, I was over there in Berlin and decided to sort of put some feelers out and see if anybody from the Berlin dub massive were interested in having a chat or a beer or just something. And it turned out to be something completely unexpected. Mr. Peter Withoutfield from Blog Rebellion got together with Volker Tripp from Ideology Records, and they have put a thing called together called Tassibierr. And you can find more about Tassibierr at blogrebellion.de/Tassibierr. That's T-A-S-S-E-B-I-E-R, which basically stands for Cup of Beer. And it's a regular sort of get-together of people that are in the Creative Commons and musical creative sector. And they interviewed me on video. And here's a little bit of me being interviewed by Volker.
Net audio, although, is still very much of a niche phenomenon. It's not really recognized, you know, by a very broad audience. Do you think it will be bigger? What do you think will be the future of net audio?
I think that audio will be consumed on the net. Whether that means net audio as you understand it from your net label, or whether that just means everyone will consume everything from the internet, is something different. I think, you know, at some point we will all have the radio stations in Berlin, the radio stations in London, the radio stations anywhere will all be on the internet as the primary medium. And at some point, all music will be available, and you will flick through your internet device, your mobile phone, whatever, and pick up anything. And then it'll all be net audio. But from what you do and what I want to do with the music, I don't think it's ever going to get mainstream. We kind of like it underground, don't we? We kind of like being, you know, we don't want to be that popular. We want to do something different. Well, you want to be popular, I don't know.
Not me, but I like the music that I put out to be popular.
Oh yeah, that's true. Yeah, that's true. So Twitter is a pretty good medium for sort of getting the stuff out, I guess.
But it's largely social media then?
I think it's just people just looking for stuff. So, for example, there was a lady in America. She'd no idea who I was. She'd no idea anything about it. She was a lawyer from somewhere in... Where was she? Southern America, somewhere. North America, but southern states. And she sent me a note saying, somebody I know has a website. They put a link onto your website. I followed it and downloaded one of your shows. I love it. But I don't know anything about podcasting. What do I do? So I just told her, she said, you know, can I pay for your shows? Can I buy something? Can I download it? Will it expire? All the sort of stuff you normally get with sort of, you know, digital, you know, rights management on normal stuff. So I said, okay, you know, it's free for you forever. She was like, oh my God. And here's how you get it. And she was just so happy. So, you know, from now on, she's a fan. And she will hopefully be a fan of other podcasters and other people that have that music and push it out. So... Thank you.
Still one of my favourite pieces of liquid drum and bass. That is Kosmonaut with a K on a track called Atmospheric Flower, which came out on Ideology Records. And you find that at ideology.de. Before that, we had Volker and myself talking with Peter Withoutfield, not saying anything, but videoing from Tassibierr. On Blog Rebellion and Ideology Records, and that was more than interesting. I felt really, you know, quite honoured to be sort of the guest of honour for that conversation. And then we went off for a few beers and a conversation, and it was absolutely wonderful. So great stuff. And you know, check out the guys that have been the Berlin Dub Massive, especially Sechmo, who's still producing his Echo Chamber mixes and podcasts. So definitely worth checking them out. Right, in August 2011, I went up to see Vince. And Ginger Shinobi from Broken Drum Records, and they were doing a DJ set up in London, and well, it didn't go quite according to plan.
That was an interesting experience. What just happened?
Well, I arranged a club night at the Thomas Beckett in South London. I did all the liaising with the manager, who's a lovely guy called Alex. And, we seem to have had a breakdown in communication, even though my poster, which you can see here,
says
hip-hop, global beats, IDM, which stands for intelligent dance music, transnational dubstep, afrobeat, transglobal breakbeat science. And I said we're going to play normal club music with a world feel. That's how I simplified it.
And then Vince got on the decks.
Vince got on the decks and took it hard. He was playing quite, I think, what's known as mumbacore, quite techie, almost techno-y mumbaton. And, it didn't go down well.
It didn't go down well.
So we essentially got told to start playing more soulful music or leave, and that this venue wasn't for us.
Right. So luckily...
Luckily, my esteemed DJ colleague George Luke stepped into the DJ booth and seemed to be playing some sort of rare group soul thing, which sounds great from out
yep,
here.
Yep.
But this is the end of our career as disc jockeys at the Thomas Beckett.
stuff. That was Ginger Shinobi and his track called Moomba Bandit. And you can find that at bdodancefloor.bandcamp.com. Now, BDO Dance Floor was a short-lived version of the dance floor version of Broken Drum Records, which, of course, is where you'll find Secret Archives of the Vatican, which was where Vince comes from. And Ginger does a little bit of the work on that. And I thought that was a conversation we had earlier on about the rather failed attempt at a DJ residency, but it was rather interesting nevertheless. Right, in December 2011, the end of 2011, I was very lucky. I went up to get my daughter from university, who was based up in Norwich, and we popped in to the John Peel Centre for the Creative Arts, which was just about being put together at that time. It's now up and running and has lots of gigs and stuff there. And I met John Spitzer, who's helping put the thing together, Mr. Clitheroe, who's always there, let's face it, he's always there, and the amazing Sheila Ravenscroft, of course, the widow of John Peel. I was a bit starstruck, I have to say, but here's a little short interview, part of the interview I had with them.
And I'm joined by not only my usual mate, my Mr. Clitheroe. Hello, sir.
Good afternoon, Coach. How are you doing?
I'm doing very well. But John, is it John Spitzer?
It is John.
John
yes,
Spitzer,
yes.
From who's the director of this lovely establishment?
One of the directors, yes.
One of the directors. And we have the patron herself, the lovely Sheila, Sheila Ravenscroft. Hello.
Hello. Hello, hello.
So, John, tell us a bit more about what can I and my listeners not see? What can you tell us in words that our listeners can have a.
Oh, wow. It is a lovely old Victorian building, tremendous height, tremendous light. Open and airy, perfect for a venue to celebrate the arts. Perfect. Lovely brickwork.
What was it in the past?
It was a corn exchange, corn hall. It's been a movie theater, it's been a pool hall. They've done exhibitions in here, but it actually sat empty for the last 15 years at least. And during that time, it was used mainly for just a maintenance shop for the town council. But when we started talking to the community about it, they said that they wanted an arts center for the whole community.
Right.
And it's developed from there, and we've contacted Sheila about using John's name and her coming on as patron and taking over as lead for media and
building
and events and volunteers and everything else that we could possibly get her involved with. And there's no stopping her now. She's involved with everything.
So what prompted you to sort of say yes to this, then, Sheila? What was it? What was it about it that you liked?
I'm just incredibly bad at saying no. And John was right. There's nothing in John's name in the area, which was nice that people wanted it. And actually, now that we've been going, a year and a half?
A year and a half.
Everybody in the area and further is really, really cottoned onto it and is really excited about it. So it's sort of almost proved that it was a good idea.
Yeah.
And it's not just like young people, it's everybody. And so we've
got even Clithers and I, you know.
Yeah, get that. and you've got all these, you know, the older generation who remember it during the war and da da da. And they all say, oh, it's so nice, the building's been used. And so there's a huge cross section of people who are just really chuffed that it's been used,
And indeed, they were, and it's taken a wee while for the John Peel to get together, but it was put together, and it does sort of seem produce a lot of gigs there now, so definitely worth checking them out. Right, moving on then. So March 2012, I had a Skype conversation with Mark Lee from the Pocket Gods. We heard a little bit from Mark Lee and the Pocket Gods a bit earlier on, but he gives us a bit of an explanation of where the lead singer Annalise at the time came from, and where one of the songs came from. So have a listen to this. It's rather interesting.
It was me, Claire, and Annalise. That's Claire's cousin. And she came to live with us one summer down in Sandwich in St. Albans. And we used to just hang out all the time because I wasn't working and she was at sixth form and Claire wasn't working either. So we just hung out all day in the garden and wrote songs and went to the pub. And it was good fun, halcyonic times. And one of the times we went to a local jumble sale in the village just for a laugh, really, and it was just like serious carnage. There's all these old dears on a mission to try and get this teddy bear and these soiled clothes and elbowing you out the way. It was like, oh my lord, it was like being at the front row of a Metallica concert, but with worse hygiene. It was just and I remember Annalise had never been to anywhere like that before, and she saw this womble that she wanted, soft toy, and she just couldn't get it. The grannies were just beating her away, and it was a bit scary. And so after that, we were a bit scarred by that experience. So we went to our local pub, the Green Man, had lunch, and wrote that song that afternoon.
To the truffle party. Let's all go searching for treasure. 20-year mission on a Saturday morning. Standing inside outside is boring. Stake my claim to the second-hand truffle. Fight to the death in the middle of the jungle. Push through folks to my table treasure. Not wearing velvet suit pleasure. Let's all go to the jungle party. Let's all go searching for treasure. Let's all go to the jungle party. Let's all go searching for treasure. Jungle party, jungle party, jungle party, jungle waffle. Jungle party, jungle party, jungle party, jungle party.
I can't get out, I can't get out, can't get out, I'm trapped. Can't get out, can't get out, can't get out, I'm trapped. Can't get out, can't get out, can't get out, I'm trapped with my treasure. Steal my seats of velvet leisure.
Smelly old men with folding sacks. Search for change and crash their cracks. Crowd sits our reduction minister. This experience feels quite sinister. Examine our treasure. Still no suits of velvet leisure. Souls are bruised but we're still fooling. Put this down to rock and rolling. Jungle party, jungle party, jungle party, jungle party. Jungle party, jungle party, jungle party, jungle party.
Can't get out, can't get out, can't get out, I'm trapped. Can't get out, can't get out, can't get out, I'm trapped. Can't get out, can't get out, can't get out, I'm trapped. With a treasure, steal my seats of velvet measure.
Let's all go to the jumble party. Let's all go to the jumble party. Let's all go to the jumble party. Let's all go to the jumble party.
Marvellous. Don't think I want to go to the Jumble Party, but that was the Pocket Gods, and you can find them at facebook.com/thepocketgods, of course. And then before that, we had Motley explaining that particular track and a bit more about it. Wonderful stuff it was, too. Right, we now jump a year. I haven't done much interviewing in 2012, so I jump a year to 2013, when my ex-next door neighbour, I might have mentioned him before, because we mentioned Vinyl Cord, the young band that I followed, and they were in part one of this two-part podcast. But Jim Warren was the father of the bassist, Dylan, and it was Dylan's birthday, his 21st birthday, and Jim being not one to sort of hold back and do things, he just doesn't do things by halves, said, "What do you want for your birthday, son?" And he said, "I want a festival." So the Tickeridge Festival, held in the grounds of their home, was rather marvellous. I went along and I had a chat with Jim about the whole thing, and then we had to listen to something from Zimbaremabwe, Mbira Vibes. I'll try and rehearse that the next time I say it, but have a listen to what they say.
Originally, I was going to sort out all the supplies, catering, marquees, sound engineers, and Dylan was going to sort the bands out, but unfortunately, just got immersed in work. So I had to jump in and start organising.
Sounds like you were really upset by that, yeah.
Yeah, I know. as you know me, Peter, I like a project.
You never do a project to sort of minuscule proportions, though, do you? You always go full on. This is brilliant.
Like most things, you can do it so your heart knows it's right, but I'll tell you what it does. If your heart's in the right place and your wallet's full, the combination of the two really helps, because it's cost quite a bit.
So are you thinking you missed your calling? You should have been a promoter, an empresario then?
Absolutely not. anyway, Jim Goldstein doesn't roll off the tongue that easy. I just, no, not really.
Has it been hard then?
It's not been hard. I must admit, I don't know if you're going to put this out, dealing with the bands and the management, if they've got a manager, they've been a little bit naughty. But hey, you know, it's all.
So what would you, what does a band need to do to get themselves hired?
A very simple thing. It's maybe a little bit too technical for a lot of them. It's called, if you've got a Facebook entry, read your comments. If you've got a new thing called a computer, read your emails.
Right.
That's all it is. Don't ask me questions about what's happening when you've got an email 3 weeks ago and then followed up 2 weeks ago. You know, just
so bands like to play music, but they don't like to correspond.
No.
It's a sad thing, isn't it? Because, I mean, I've heard it before that all you need is 1,000 good fans and you've got yourself a living. So, you know, still to respond to 1,000... I mean, it's not going to be 1,000 emails. It's going to be, you know, 5 of those. 5 emails a week or something to do that. But, yeah, so anyway, you've learned the experience. Are you going to do it again?
Absolutely not.
I'll ask you that next year.
Absolutely not.
Musica na canne di ciacupa, ciacco. bona kane ndi chakupa zvako rega kuchema musikana kane ndi chakupa zvako munairo riyara unochema pasi pemuti munairo riyara unochema musango rinoera Chema pasi benanga, munairo riara uno chema pasi bekuta, munairo riara uno chema pasi beninga. Rega kuchema la kama nakadi, rega kuchema ni chakupa yere, rega kuchema musika nakadi.
Zimbaremabwe Mbira vibes and a track called Rege Rega Kochma, which is rather good. And they are based at Zimbaremabwe.org. You'll find that by going to PCPKogel.com and looking up PCP 600 Part 2. And before that, we heard Jim talking about the Tickeridge Festival and how the fact he's always wanted to do it again, which he never did. Hardly surprising, hardly surprising. Now, there wasn't an awful lot of interviewing going on in 2015 and 2016 because part of the time the podcast was not being operated. But there was a little bit of a conversation between me and Mr. Clitheroe and Mr. Snelling at The Great Escape. So here's a bit of some of the mumblings from that.
So we're on the station and we haven't got a train waiting for us like we have the last 2 days, but we're back here. So, day two, thoughts?
Good day.
Good day?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Aside from the fact that we walked 18 kilometres or something of that nature.
I had a nice sit down for an hour.
Yeah, yeah. you sat down for an hour while somebody mutilated your body while we went to a gay rave.
We did, didn't we?
We did.
I can't remember who we saw yesterday that was just so, so good.
Yeah.
It was the Irish. Yeah.
Which one of us had the worst time, I wonder?
Well, there were a lot of pricks involved in both cases.
And four in a row in both cases.
Ooh, yeah, but I'm still sore.
It's two of us. No, stop it, stop it. Ooh, the train's going to go now.
It is.
Should we wait for the noise of the train departing before we say any more bollocks?
Well, we could wait for it to start before we stop saying any bollocks and then wait.
Then we could, yeah, absolutely, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's not going yet.
It's not, well, it's going now.
Oh, he's now,
there
yeah.
There it goes.
It would get on better if they didn't track those lumps of metal along the way.
Exactly. Exactly.
Just stood on my foot and he looked at me. Didn't say anything, I said, it's alright, mate, I've got another one. Thank you very much. Okay. Lovely. Cheers, Paul.
Oh, No, it's not all about me, as I said. It's sometimes it's about somebody else who wants to interview me. In April 2018, Omar Willie from the Seattle Star decided to interview me, and I put out various bits of the interview, and he asked me this rather important question.
When did you first listen to John Peel in your memory?
Ooh, that is sometime in the 70s, so I couldn't remember exactly which. It's probably in the region of about somewhere between 74 and 76, I would guess. 74, I was 13, and I was just about getting into the good stuff. So I guess it was around about then. And certainly by 76, when the punk explosion started, I was listening on a regular basis then. So,
so this was a good inspiration for you?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, the guy was clearly a genius, and he did everything that different from everybody else, i.e. he played what he wanted to play and got away with it.
I was a college DJ for 4 years in Bellingham, and then when I left school and came back to Seattle, I joined, well, it was KCMU then, it is now KEXP.
Right.
And I stayed there 6 years. And we had an open kind of format then, but it was still nothing as exciting as John Peel ever did, certainly. Despite the nominal freedom that we would have, we actually have it worse in many ways because there are very few eclectic programs the way that his was. So obviously your podcast is very influenced by Peel's method of going about and assembling eclectic programs then, yes?
Yeah, I'd like to think that I can sometimes put tracks together that I juxtapose to be similar, and sometimes I put tracks together to juxtapose to be completely different, to deliberately wake the listener up and say, you know, have you thought about this? So that's what I like to try and do, if at all possible.
I think that's excellent. And that's the effect that your podcast often has on me, which is why I'm talking to you now.
Sounds good. Sounds good.
And it is always nice to hear somebody else want to have a conversation with me about something, you know, other than what they're doing. But yeah, it was great to talk to Omar, and big thanks to him. You can find him at seattlestar.net, where he puts all these journalistic hostings and stuff up there. Good stuff. Right, moving on to November 2018, I met up with Lewis Lingg and the Bombs. They came over from Paris to play in London, and I couldn't resist. I went along, and I had a chat with Josh and the others, but this is the bit when I was having a chat with Josh and worked out how on earth he ended up going from Wales to Paris.
So, how does a guy from Wales end up in a punk band in France?
I moved to Liverpool. I did a digital hardcore band called Dummy Crusher.
Right.
That was fun. And then from Liverpool, there was lots of French people avoiding the draft because there was still national service back in those days to go to the army. And I started hanging out with all loads of French people, and then we moved to Paris with them. And then in Paris, I got playing like cover bands, and they were awful. Then I got into a band called Cheeky Boom, and we played like stuff that was very much like Franz Ferdinand.
Okay.
But before Franz Ferdinand.
Right.
And then Franz Ferdinand came out and did it much better than us. And then I formed Lewis Lingg and the Bombs.
Come crashing down, just like it. Whoa, 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 whoa.
Bring It On, they did. That was Lewis Lingg and the Bombs. You can find them at lewislingandthebombs.bandcamp.com. That's Lingg with two G's, if you're not quite sure. And before that, we heard Josh talking about how he ended up moving from Wales via Liverpool to Paris, where he's stayed ever since and has now got a wife and two kids, and works as a production, a music production guy, and he's worked with some amazing people from all sorts of music genres. So good stuff it was too. I hope you enjoyed that, and I hope you've enjoyed the whole show. This is now the end of PCP 600 Part 2. I think I need to get my arse in gear and do a bit more interviewing for 2019, don't you? I think so. I'll give it a go. I'll see how it gets. I'll get on. I might take a week off after this. It's been quite stressful getting all this together. I might take a week off and have a bit of a break. Then again, I might not. You never can tell with me. I just like podcasting so much. So until I come back, see you soon, folks.
Most agreeable.
Most agreeable, yes.
So, are we tired?
No, no. I'm knackered.
Okay.
Not as tired as I was last year.
Well, you're not as old this year as you were then.
Oh, that's true. That's wearing off now.